Hey everybody, and welcome to this episode of Esports Wave. We got a couple things to talk about, so let's hop right in with the Overwatch League. I know I've been really focusing on this a lot. It has been dominating a lot of my news feeds. I know I've been bringing it up a lot, but it is important to pay attention to. Up until this point, Riot has really been the only company to pay attention to the competitive scene to this degree. And even then, I still feel like Blizzard's taken it above and beyond with trying to fully incorporate all of it. So most likely, I will be keeping an eye on it from this point forward. And with last week's matches wrapping up, we've reached an important shift. For a while there in this season, there were teams that seemed undefeatable. This was of course a worry for me, because if an entire tournament is completely controlled by one team, what's the point in anyone watching? There's no drama, there's no interest. Well, both Seoul and New York, titans in their divisions, have both suffered losses. And not just a single map in a set, they've actually lost the full match. This of course makes the titans of the league look less invulnerable and should create some pretty interesting rivalries moving forward. Alternatively in the league, we have a sort of, I guess, pure underdog? If you haven't been watching, of all the teams who have been underperforming consistently, it's been the Shanghai Dragons. Even the presenters bring this up at a consistent pace now during the actual matches. It's been pretty disheartening, not just for the players, but honestly for the fan base. And this early on, they need to maintain that to keep the franchise alive. Now, by no means are these players bad. It just seems like there's been some mismanagement or some lack of practice to understand the current meta of the game. And in an attempt to let the fans know that they understand that this of course seems bad, the manager for the Shanghai Dragons, Van, has actually put forward a full-blown apology. Now this seems a little odd. We're only in the first part of the first season for the entire league, and to drop an apology this early? I have to admit, I'm really interested in what happens. If the Shanghai Dragons make it to the end of the first season and can't even pull a victory, they have won several maps, but they can't seem to hold it together for the entire set. It will be interesting to see what happens going forward, seeing as how Blizzard has allowed for roster changes to occur even this far into the first season's lifetime. As I've said, I'll try to keep an eye on the league and see how things progress. For now, let's take a look over at CSGO. If you're a fan of first-person shooters, especially in a competitive capacity, the fact that an American team just won a major should be pretty exciting. This is pretty incredible. Throughout my competitive history, I tend to come across players from all over the world, and usually when they talk about American gamers, the focus is on the fact that a lot of us have great skill, but when it comes to a team game, we tend to just fall apart. CSGO undeniably requires a lot of skill, but it also requires a ton of team play. So the American approach of a more pickup game attitude tends to not work out. But Cloud9 overcame this and actually showed the world that yes, we can really take a look at the meta of a game and actually conquer it strategically. Now this, coupled with the explosive growth of the CSGO competitive community, should hopefully allow players to realize the importance of team play gaming in a team play competitive situation. And I get it, most people don't want to turn their microphone or headset on because they don't want to listen to a little kid yell expletives at them for a while. But maybe you just mute that person and listen to the people who actually have interesting strats to talk about. I'd like to think this could be ushering in an era of competitive cooperation. I mean, I doubt it, but one can dream. And with that, let's take a look over to Dota 2. Recently, the ESL attempted to put on a major tournament for the game. And in the process of trying to find partners for this, Facebook came into their sights. As a service, Facebook tends to not be thought of as a center for streaming and gaming. So to host one of the bigger events in one of the bigger competitive games, it would be a pretty big boon for Facebook, and I'm pretty sure they put in a pretty penny for it to try to maintain some exclusivity. The problem is, as it turns out, there's a reason Facebook isn't thought of for this. Through glitches, errors, and almost a straight-up inability to watch any of the games on the service, it kind of angered a lot of fans. A few upright citizens in the community decided to take it upon themselves to use the in-game spectation mode to broadcast the games on their own channels. These could of course be found on the more common of streaming services. But in this instance, in the attempt to keep the friendship together between ESL and Facebook, a lot of the moderators from ESL decided to take it upon themselves to DMCA strike down these streams and even get a few of these guys banned for a little bit. For the bulk of the tournament, the focus of these moderators was to make sure there was no other way to get access to this broadcast unless you either used Dota 2 yourself or you viewed it through Facebook. Now, of course, these DMCAs had the fans out in the classic pitchfork and torches method. It even had Valve stand up and chastise the ESL for doing this. citing the specific reason that ESL doesn't actually own the replay function that the Dota 2 client has built in. It's known as Dota 2 TV, and the copyright for it's held by Valve. No one at ESL owns this. So to pop in on these streams and actually claim them, it's a little bit bad for business. This, of course, portrays Valve in the positive light of trying to maintain the community and allowing community members to do what they can to kind of preserve the competitive scene. But on the flip side, it also kind of points out that it's going to be hard in the future for these third-party events to actually find partners willing to stick with them. If I was the owner of a major company and I was looking to get my brand noticed by the esports community, why would I use Dota 2 when it was almost a guarantee that maybe the viewership for my sponsored tournament just wouldn't hit a good number simply because there was a personality on the side who decided to stream the tournament as well through the system, and I had no control over whether or not that was not allowed. Because in this instance, those restreams at times were hitting 10 times the amount of viewership than the Facebook stream was even getting at all. It's not a good look for these third-party tournament coordinators, and it kind of makes Dota 2 look like a bad investment for some of these outside sources. I know the game's exploded heavily since its release. Despite not receiving the viewership that League of Legends gets on an almost daily basis on a lot of these streaming services, it's still able to put out way more money through the tournaments. But as Valve's policies with the game become a little more clear that it's not corporation-friendly, these tournaments might become less and less interesting to potential investors. We'll have to see what happens as this moves forward. It was an interesting turn of events, and I'm a little disappointed in it. And at this point, one of the main takeaways I have with this is that maybe Facebook isn't a good idea for streaming major events. It's probably that. Well, these were some of the major stories in the esports arena these past couple weeks. If you liked what you saw, don't forget there's a little thumbs up button below. And if you're interested in gaming news and tech, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. See you all next time.